Welcome to the PV online course in photovoltaics. In this chapter, we will deal with the question, how does a solar cell work? In this teaching unit, the properties of semiconductors are explained. As in the last teaching unit, we start with the two-dimensional spatial representation of a solid. We first consider a metal lattice. The core atoms consisting of protons, neutrons, and inner electrons are simply positively charged. In contrast, the electrons of the outer shell are not bound to the atomic nucleus. They can move freely and are also called electron gas. This results in a very good conductivity. The specific electrical resistance of metal is less than 10 to the power of minus 5 ohm centimeter. The opposite is true for the insulator. Here also the electrons of the outer shell are bound to an atomic nucleus. So the electrons cannot move. This causes a very bad conductivity. The specific electrical resistance in insulators is greater than 10 to the power of 7 ohm centimeter. The properties of a semiconductor are between those of a conductor and an insulator. The specific electrical resistance of a semiconductor is between 10 to the power of minus 5 ohm centimeter and 10 to the power of 7 ohm centimeter. In the semiconductor, the electrons are partly bound to atomic nuclei. Partially, however, the electrons can move freely. Where electrons have detached from the atomic nucleus and leave the core atom, so-called holes are formed, which can also move. But what is a hole? And how does such an electrical conduction through holes work? An analogy to a parking garage helps us here. Imagine you want to go shopping in downtown Cologne or another city on Saturday at noon. The access to the upper parking deck is blocked. In the lower parking deck, all parking bays are occupied. Out of sheer desperation, you stand in the access line. Other drivers get the same idea. When you return from shopping, the entire parking deck is blocked. No one can move. Everything is blocked. You are at ground zero. This also corresponds to the situation in a semiconductor at absolute zero. At some point, the parking management decides to release the upper parking deck. This corresponds to the temperature increase in a semiconductor. Individual cars can now enter the upper parking deck. These cars can then play James Bond and move freely around the upper parking deck. But also on the lower parking deck, cars can start to move. The cars can move from gap to gap. Of course, this is more time consuming. For this reason, the mobility of holes in a semiconductor is about a factor of 10 lower than the mobility of electrons. We now also want to understand, as announced, in addition to the spatial representation of the charge carriers, the energetic approach. In the metal, the valence and conduction bands overlap. But since the conduction band is not occupied with electrons, the electrons from the valence band can move freely here. It is like a fully occupied parking deck with totally free access to the upper, totally free parking deck. Of course, the drivers will drive to the upper deck in this case. In the insulator, on the other hand, there is a large band gap between valence and conduction band. The large band gap corresponds to the blocking of the upper parking deck with simultaneous overfilling of the lower parking deck. In a semiconductor, the band gap is smaller and single electrons can, depending on the temperature, pass from the valence into the conduction band, leaving a hole in the valence band behind. If the band gap is larger than 4 electron volts, the material is called an insulator. If it is smaller than 4 electron volts, it is called a semiconductor. In a semiconductor, electrons can be lifted from the valence into the conduction band by thermal excitation. They leave a hole with a positive charge, here marked in dark gray, in the valence band. But also the energy of a photon can be sufficient to transport a hole from the valence into the conduction band. The photon must have at least the energy of the band gap before it is absorbed. We now consider semiconductors with different band gaps. The band gaps are given at room temperature. First, we will look at semiconductors with comparatively low band gap, like silicon, with a band gap of 1.12 electron volt, or germanium with a band gap of only 0.67 electron volt. In such semiconductors with low band gap, a significant number of electrons are in the conduction band at room temperature. This is different for semiconductors with comparatively large band gap. Here only a few electrons are in the conduction band at room temperature. Typical semiconductors, which are also used in photovoltaics and have a higher band gap, are, for example, gallium arsenide, which is used for space solar cells, or cadmium telluride, which is used for low-cost solar modules in very large solar parks. We have now mentioned several times the energy unit electron volts. But how much energy is one electron volt? Well, in electron volt there is once V volt and E the elementary charge. The elementary charge is 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 ampere seconds. If you put this into the equation for the energy of a band gap, we get 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 ampere seconds times volt. This is 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 watt seconds. So, one electron volt is 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 joule. We conclude. While conductors have no band gap and insulators have a very large band gap, the band gap of semiconductor is less than 4 electron volt. In semiconductors, electrons can be lifted from the valence to the conduction band by thermal energy or with the help of a photon. The conductivity of semiconductors is strongly dependent on the band gap. The energy of 1 electron volt corresponds to 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 19 joule. We have now understood electron and hole conduction. We got a feeling for the energy of the band gap of different semiconductors. In the next teaching unit, we will look at another way to lift electrons from the valence into the conduction band. Thank you for your attention.